What you doing peeking in them people's window?
One, two.
It is Eytan Shander, Mr. Walt of the Beatminerz.
Hello,
Mr.
hello. Walt.
On the one and two, spinning throughout the show, and former Pro Bowler, former All-Pro, former Defensive Rookie of the Year, Mr. Hugh Douglas.
Hello.
What's good, fellas?
How you doing?
Hey, what's up?
Former Eagle Hugh, big Giants fan, Mr. Walt.
That's
I'll
right.
be in the middle as an Eagles fan. I promise I won't be biased. Lie right there.
You know what, though? I got to say, with this hot beat that Mr. Walt's playing,
I
can't hate him as much as I would this week because he's a Giants fan. Because, you know, like, this week is the worst week for Giants fans to be around because they like to trash talk and talk about the Super Bowls they have recently won and how we don't have any. And it makes you want to punch him in the face.
Why?
But Mr. Walt, the beat is so banging
Thank
that
you,
I'm just like, you know, and he's such a nice guy. He does remind me of the average Giants fan.
You know what it is? It's music, man.
Yeah.
It diffuses everything.
It's banging. It's banging. I like the beat.
Thank you, sir.
So that's what we'll do. We'll have music playing throughout the show, you know. Nice little theme through it, and hopefully it'll calm Hugh down as well. How about
that? You know what, man? I'm not hyped, but I am hyped about the all-black uniforms. And that, just to see that, man, and knowing that that Philly's getting hyped for that, it makes me wish I was back in Philadelphia so I could see this game.
Well, this is the rivalry, right? When we think about rivalries in sports, Yankees, Red Sox, you know, if you want to throw in a hockey one here or there, there's a baseball, you know, the NFL, Cowboys, the old stuff is gone. With the NFC East now, really the last 4 or 5 years, it's been Giants and Eagles.
You know what? It's still the Cowboys. We still hate the Cowboys.
But everybody hates the Cowboys.
But I tell you what it is. It started with LeSean McCoy and OCU Miura.
Yeah.
When they start trash talking. And then it was like, oh, you know, like I mean, with all due respect to OC, I'm like, they won the Super Bowl. I respect LeSean. For saying what he said, even though you didn't win anything. But it's like, ooh, it's like you got to kind of like, you know what I mean? You got to pay deference to the big boy on the block. They just won one, and you talking trash. So I like the fact that he was talking trash, but it's like, ooh. So it became like a trash talking thing.
Well, okay.
It's been ongoing.
See, that's the point, and that's the problem that I have, fellas. I'm okay if you have the jewelry to back it up. You can say whatever you want because you won it, right?
Yeah.
But the problem that I have is if you are doesn't really cover – or Prince, you know, you like that, right?
Yeah.
That's your boy, DRC.
Yeah,
doesn't
DRC.
Really, you know that, but if you doesn't really cover or Prince and you don't have the jewelry, I don't know about all that one.
But you are a Giant and people see you. You know, most fans see them as Giants players, even though they weren't on the Super Bowl team. Most Giants fans look at them as Super Bowl champions because it's been so recent.
I can't get over the license plate guy. You have to explain that to us.
That's New York. It's not like that in Philly. You know what I mean? You know how Philly, we're like everything is like in segments. You know, you have the 92 team with Reggie White and all those guys, Jerome Brown.
Yeah.
And then you have the team that I play with, you know, Troy Vincent, Bobby Taylor, and those guys. We don't mix our teams. We don't do that.
But the Giants, you're right.
But the Giants do. The Giants do. If you play for the Giants,
it's a legacy.
You were part of that Super Bowl, even if you didn't. You weren't on the team. You weren't even born.
It's like that with the Yankees too.
That's a great point, Mr. Walt, because you don't find that, right, Hugh? You don't find that with a lot of other teams, being in the NFL, baseball, NBA, where maybe the Lakers.
Yeah, Lakers too.
Where when you step in, you step into the culture.
You step into that legacy,
right?
Yes.
But also think about that, like the Celtics. I think people could say, but the Celtics have been so much, they've been so trash last couple. That's kind of gone. You telling me that there's Celtic pride now? If you get drafted by the Celtics, you're pumped up?
Not right now, but they're on the uprise. They're trying to build.
It's a prestigious.
It's hard in basketball.
You put that green and white on, you know what I'm saying? It's a legacy. Like
you still
said,
think so?
It's a legacy. Listen. You're looking up at Boston. It's Boston Garden. Right? I'm an old man. This is Boston Garden, right?
Right?
Look, you're looking up. You're seeing Bird, McHale, you know what I'm saying? Even Pierce. You see what they bring to the table. So with the new guy, like, you know, Rondo already got one. But, like, the new guys coming in, they're looking up, and I'm like, yo, wow, I'm here. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
That means something. It means something.
Yeah.
And, you know, you look at what the
Even when you win
done,
in 18 games a year, it means something?
Man, you know what? You're still a Celtic.
Yeah.
You're still a part of that. But as far as the Giants are concerned, I mean, they have a rich legacy too.
Yes.
Yeah.
They have a rich legacy. You know, Strahan just went into the Hall of Fame.
Yep.
LT. You know, when I think of the Giants, I love LT. Hate that he was a Giant, but I got love for LT because who didn't want to be LT growing up? And then, you know, I had a chance to meet him, and it didn't even matter that he played for the Giants. I just sat there and I talked to him and just listened to some of the stories. That LT has the best stories that you could ever hear anybody tell.
I'm sure because not one of them is PG.
No, listen.
Right?
Most of the time, he would tell you he was drunk when he was playing, and I'm looking at him like, wow, this cat would be drunk playing and get like four sacks.
But you won't follow that lead. You won't.
No, I can't do that.
Yeah.
No.
You can't do
but
that.
You know, it takes a special kind of animal.
Yeah.
To be able to go out there and do that, man.
Can
and, you know,
comprehend that? I mean, you're a former All Pro.
Nah.
All right. I covered you in Philly.
Nah, can't do that. Couldn't imagine it. I couldn't go out there with a full stomach and play. Can't eat on Sunday. Can't eat nothing.
I know somebody told me, not to name names or anything, but you know,
name it,
used
name
to
it.
No. Used to smoke before a game.
I used to hear people say that.
That's the last thing I would think. If you're high, that you want to go around and get hit.
I heard guys used to have other things that they used to do before the game and go out there and wild out. And I'm like, wow.
Wait, but, not like not stuff to jack you up.
Stuff to jack you up.
Like amphetamine stuff?
Well, yeah, I guess that's what you want.
Powder?
All right, you
but you know that like, you know, the Irvin stuff, right? Like I can understand that. I won't do it. I'm not condoning it, but I can understand that if you are out there trying to add to your performance, right? Obviously it's not legal. But if you're adding stuff in your body to make you more jacked up, to get you more fired up, that's one thing. But the downers, you know, beer, weed, stuff like that is crazy.
Well, some people probably need to relax and they don't want to get too excited. I've seen guys like that. You know, I've
where
seen
they
guys
just get crazy and
they get too excited. I used to have a teammate that before he played, he had to get slapped because he was so hyped. And he had to get slapped and cats used to slap him and it was the funniest thing. I'm not gonna put him out there like that. But he used to walk in the locker room and say, "Somebody slap me. I'm just too excited." And they would slap smoke out his ass. And it was like, I used to laugh so hard. But, man, I mean, to be in an NFL locker room on game day and just to see those different personalities come together, it's nothing like it. I mean, you know, people want to get close to the game. It gets no closer than game day when you see that. It's ridiculous.
And that's the stuff, too, that you never get a glimpse of.
No.
I don't care how deep your credential is.
No.
That's the stuff that curtain is always down.
Yeah.
So good to have Hugh Douglas, Mr. Wall, the Beatminerz, Eytan Shander. It is For the Record.
I think Jxhnsxn is better than Ghost on some rhyme. Like, on
some
the rhyme
stuff?
Tip, Jxhnsxn might be better.
I can quote any Jxhnsxn, and it's just beautiful.
I'm going to tell you what. I'm 46. I'm showing my age, people. I'm 46 years old, so I go back. Ghostface represents the Hard Rocks.
Yeah.
We had a term in New York called the Hard Rocks. These are guys that used to wear the bubble goose coats and the ski hats, and you just wear the flyers clothes, and you just walk with a bop. That's Ghostface.
Uh-huh.
Ghostface represent my era.
Yeah, because he used to always have furs and the Timbs.
Yeah.
You remember that big old bird medallion he had?
Yeah.
Like, Ghostface was that dude.
Yeah,
he
man.
He was that guy.
Yep.
He is that guy. I'll still go crazy for a Ghostface record when it comes out.
His verse on that track, Projects, my goodness. That might do it right there.
So, yo, Hugh, here's Sally. Sally with a one-track mind, Diamond. Tell me if you know this record.
I hate to say this, I have never
it goes
heard
back
this.
It goes back. What's 91?
I have never heard this.
Think about that, 1991.
I have never heard this.
But you know what though, if this track were to come out today, people would be banging it.
Yeah.
So that's
Dude,
why I asked.
I don't know. You know, I don't remember this. I'm sorry.
It's all good. It's all good.
No, because I'm like, wow, I have never heard this ever.
I thought I knew all types of music, but when you said Raheem the Dream and Tila,
yeah, you know what's
Tila
funny?
Tila used to be with No Limit or something like
no,
that?
No, Tila was with Suave House.
Suave House.
He was with Suave House.
Okay.
And he had one album, then he had another one, but it didn't do as well. Like his first album was banging. Peace of Mind was banging.
Okay.
Like the whole thing, you could play it straight through. And then I don't know what happened. Suave House, you know, Suave House. I don't know what happened with Suave House.
Yeah.
But I know A-Ball MJG left, and that's when they went with Puffy. and they did that, and it just changed. But Tila, hey, Memphis legend. Yeah. All day.
Wow.
All right, before we get out of here, you heard the bass line, so now you know why I asked that question.
Yeah.
You still think it, deep cover's better?
I think so. Yeah. I like deep cover. Because this reminds me of.
Y'all are crazy.
But you know what, though? Woo. This reminds me of Leaders of the new School.
Okay.
Leaders of
the this does? Kinda,
yeah, this does a little bit.
You remember Best Kept Secret? Same cat, Diamond D. Anthony Mason was in the video?
Don't remember that.
They don't know about that.
Diamond D is a local. I mean, he lives in the A. He's been living in the A for years.
Uh-huh.
But he's a New York guy that kind of stayed in New York.
I remember
like
De La Soul.
Yeah.
I remember De La Soul.
Yeah.
New De La Soul really, really well.
Yeah.
Played that. LL, you know, LL.
Of course.
Yeah.
LL Cool J all day.
Yeah. Non-stop.
Yeah, Mama Said Knock You Out. I used to have that in heavy rotation.
Oh, man, I remember
that's
that.
That's the workout record.
We used to bang that on field trips.
Yeah.
You know, somebody always at the box in the back of the bus.
Oh, KRS-One. BDP.
There you go.
Yeah.
See, now you dating yourself.
Because I met, like, I met D-Nice a while ago, and I was, like a super, like, geek, like, nerdy, like,
you know about
guy.
D-Nice?
I like D-Nice.
Okay.
D-Nice was
okay.
Nice.
I knew we were cool for a reason.
No, you know, it's like.
D-Nice
it's like,
is most slept on, I think.
But, no, you know what it is? It was a lot of underground artists in New York that a lot of people didn't hear of, that had a lot of bangers that you listen to. That you didn't know who it was.
Right. Well, a lot of times you had a single that would pop, and then the album come out and it would flop.
Who else was a good, he was a good rapper, I can't think of his name. But you know, he was on the symphony. Great.
Mr. Walt of the Beatminerz, Eytan Shander, a lot more to get to for the record.
Hey you guys, it's your girl 11-8, and I'm here with the Baller Alert News of the Week. The gloves are off between Dwight Howard and his baby mama / former basketball wife star, Royce Reed. Royce claims that Dwight has physically abused their 7-year-old son, leaving marks on his body. Dwight fires back by filing for full custody, claiming that Royce has exposed their 7-year-old to inappropriate behavior. What type of inappropriate behavior? Try having his 7th birthday at Hooters, and in Dwight's words, exposing him to her many sexual partners. For the record, I completely think these two need to get it together. Do what's right for the child and stop acting like one. For more on this, make sure you follow me at balleralert.com.
It is For the Record alongside Hugh Douglas, Mr. Walt of the Beatminerz, Eytan Shander. A lot going on right now. And it is our pleasure to welcome into the show Caskey, Cash Money. Of course, his manager Doug as well.
What's up?
Fellas out of Orlando. Now, we got the hip-hop part covered with you, Caskey.
Yes,
but
sir.
We know Doug is here to help a little bit with the sports stuff as well.
I don't know anything about sports. I'm gonna make that
and you know what? Y'all gonna have to excuse me if I ask some stupid-ass questions.
Yeah.
Because I'm probably good for that, especially when it comes to the music side, because I have a lot of questions I would like to ask if we have time.
Of course we do. This is your world, Hugh.
No, because it's like new artists, especially new artists. It always fascinates me about, you know, the process of how it is, man, because, you know, I got a lot, you know how, you know, playing football, or used to playing football, a lot of cats always come to you talking about, hey, man, we got this guy, he's da-da-da-da, and it's like, dude, I don't know anything about music, and I can imagine it has to be hard.
Yeah,
to get hurt.
Football probably super hard.
No, but I mean, you know what?
All you have to do is lift weights for that.
Well, I mean, but it's a different kind of hard, though, man, because it's like, you know, when you're trying to create, and you're trying to get on, and you're trying to be heard.
Yeah.
And to get the right people to hear you.
And it's a weird balance, too, of just trying to make awesome music, but then
trying to break
the industry, you know?
Yeah, and it's like, you know what you want to sound like, but you got to have that certain person to hear you that can develop the sound.
Yeah. And sees the vision, too.
Yeah, that has to be hard, and I couldn't imagine, because, you know, like, when you talk about lifting weights, hell, you know what a weight room is.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And you know what the weights are.
Yeah.
And, you know, but to have... to just develop a sound and create and like have somebody hear you.
Yeah.
And you might be raw. You might have something and you might be raw.
Yeah.
But to have somebody hear you and know that you can actually create something. How tough is that? How tough was that role for you?
It takes some divine intervention, you know? It's like not even something that you can even plan for. You know, you make the best music you can and you work on developing your craft, but it, you know, like it take the right, you know, even just my management coming at me and like really believing in my sound. That was a big step. And then to have Birdman come out of nowhere and be like, yo, I'm fucking with what you got. That was, you know.
I mean, man, that's amazing, man. Because, I mean, you know, like, listen to What's the young fella from here now that Birdman has?
Thug.
The young Thug.
Yeah, yeah. Amber Chong.
Listen, the song, have you ever heard the song Lifestyle?
Yeah.
Smash.
Now listen, the beat, the song is banging, but if you ever hear it, for Birdman to hear like the genius in Young Thug's flow, dude, to hear the genius, because just
I
like
I catch it at first.
That's
either.
What I'm saying, because it's like you're looking
but
at
once
it.
Once you get
like,
it, you're like, oh,
and
shit.
It's like, yeah, dude, yeah. And when you like you like working with Birdman, I'm like, damn, Birdman's a fucking genius.
Yeah, he got a good ear.
Because
and,
it was like
and he picked. You gotta think too. He picked Young Thug and he picked me, and we're like, you know, so different.
Totally, that's
sonically,
what I'm saying.
You know,
and it's like
he got a real good ear.
Because when you listen to it, you gotta rewind it and be like, what the fuck did he say? And then you gotta go. You have to actually go on iTunes and look at the words, and then once you listen, you gotta listen to it about 50 times.
Rap genius got
and
that
then,
annotated.
And then you hear it. Then you can hear it. Like the more you listen to it, the more you hear it. And then you're like, damn, how the hell did you know? Because his first single was like Danny Glover. It was like Birdman heard Danny Glover. And when I heard Danny Glover, to me, I didn't like Danny Glover because I didn't like it. But when you hear the other stuff that he's done, it's like, wow, like to have somebody hear that and know that there's something in you. I mean, man, that has to be hard. Yeah. And I'm sorry,
especially
if I'm
so
taking over.
You're not taking over,
too,
it's your
you know?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, man, because I'm looking at this cat and he's on with Cash Money, and I'm like, man, I just want to hear about how did it, how what road did you take to get to where you are now?
Bro, honestly, we were, I linked up with my management. We kind of put together a plan for this project called No Complaints. So we made a solid mixtape, and we really were doing like a grassroots movement with getting it out there, you know, hitting shows, hitting different cities, giving out actual physical copies of mixtapes. And that was like a humbling experience, you know, just like actually putting your CD in people's hands and getting it denied and, you know what I'm saying, getting shit thrown on the floor, you know, like that's
get out
humbles
of my
you
office.
As a, yeah, humbles you as an artist. But we're just working, honestly, and then just one day, we got a blessing one day and just got a call from Bird, and he was like, he had heard some shit on YouTube and was like, yo, I want you to come down to Miami. I want to meet you. And we went down, met him, smoked for like hours and just played him all these records, you know what I'm saying? And like after that, we just, him and I just clicked, man. We both knew what we wanted to do with it, and I was just amazed. You know, I've been a Cash Money fan, you know, for a long time. I know Doug has too, so it was just like, yo, what the fuck, Birdman? Hell yeah, let's go.
So you got it back, man. I'm sorry.
No, why you apologize?
No, I'm saying.
Well, you see this, right? We got Hugh.
No, man, because
you know,
I just
we're talking Eagles, Giants, and he's you know, no, going through the most. Caskey comes in now.
No, I'm just, I just think it's fascinating, man, because like for artists, like I said, football is different, and you know, you have your different struggles.
Yeah.
But dude, it's so many cats out there that's rapping.
Yeah.
And it's so many cats
good
out there that
ones
have
too.
Me.
Yeah.
And it's like.
Cats.
Well, it's subjective though, right?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah,
because you got a good sound, you got a good flow, you know it, and there's people that will back it, but if there's one person who has the control, right, who's writing the checks or can expand and help you is like, nah, I'm not feeling you.
Yeah, then you just out of luck. You gotta find a different route. You know?
But I guess it
there's
speaks
so
to
many
persistence.
Talented, yeah, and there's a lot of talented rappers too that don't get heard and don't get recognized. So I think that when you do catch a break, you gotta be humbled by it and really count that as a blessing and put in the necessary work after that. You know, that's the thing a lot of people miss, too.
Hey, but I got a question for that, though. I know you say be humble, and I know that's the plan in the beginning.
Yeah.
But when you have
say
so
that on my knuckles.
Yeah, but yeah, be humble. I know that's the plan living in the beginning. But I know
that
when
going
you know I'm
this,
going because you know when they did you know when they diss
and you get shit on too coming up I noticed that too you, that's why I kind of I try not to catch feelings when I meet a rapper and they kind of a little Hollywood because coming up in this industry you get shit on so many times bro, because and you got to understand there's a million artists out there and there's a million people trying to do it so it's like yo every club promoter don't want to let you in the door every DJ don't want to fuck with you every producer don't
but
give
then
a fuck,
when they
you know?
Find out you got cash money
so sometimes
different.
I can see him being like, yeah, take that, motherfucker. Do you
hit him with but what about the females, though? Because I know, like, when you're not on, they trying to diss you.
Oh,
they
yeah,
don't want to.
Oh, yeah, fuck them. I mean,
literally.
But you get put on.
I mean, literally, though. Literally fuck them.
I didn't really, like, have female problems prior to rapping, but it's just funny now. Like, yeah, just like. You know, you already know the story.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I could just imagine because
I'm sure you get a phone call,
I got a girl,
right?
So I'm not really worried about them too much. But
I could just imagine, man, because that road that you travel, I couldn't. Because I've seen a few of my friends try to get into it.
Yeah.
And they
it's hard,
it's
man.
Hard.
Got,
and they
I
don't
got
make
tons
it.
Of homies and shit that rap. And, like, bro, it's just, it's so much work, man. And like you said, it takes a lot. Take some luck, man, and some just divine intervention, you know? I think you manifest your own destiny. So as long as you put that energy out there and put in the work,
cool.
Anything's possible.
What about the hip hop scene? You guys from being from Orlando.
Yeah.
What did the scene, is it something that helped you? Is it something that maybe you thought
in Orlando?
Yeah. Just about the hip hop scene,
so
in general.
Expand on that with me, because like I feel like the hip hop scene is developing more now in Orlando. I mean, I know there was a hip hop scene before. There was definitely artists that were, maybe I just wasn't as involved in it. You know, I was like really worried about my thing. But now that I'm in it and we're bringing some light to Orlando, I see the sound that's developing, and like we really do got like a sound and a lot of talented artists there, you know? What's your thoughts, Doug?
I mean, to compare it to sports, it's like when I drive around and see like a small town in Georgia, I saw a home of Sterling and Shannon Sharp. And it's like they're a small town. They weren't born in New York City, Miami, Florida, where there's a lot of people watching. But you still got to make the best from where you're from.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the same thing with music. You could be from a situation like Orlando where nobody's really popped out of,
yeah.
But you can't let that be an obstacle to you. You got to use your resources to get out there. Like, or in retrospect, you could move to Atlanta as a rapper and still not get on. A basketball player could go to Mount Zion and still not make the NBA.
Yeah.
Just because he's in that situation doesn't really increase his odds. If anything, now he's competing against people that may outshine them.
Right.
So if rap, if you got it, you're gonna get heard.
You gotta believe
it.
Hugh's sports. A perfect example.
Yeah.
I mean, small school,
small town from Mansfield, Ohio, home of the Mansfield Reformatory. That's the only thing people say. The Mansfield Reformatory. That's all they know about Mansfield.
I'm surprised they even know that.
They know that. But you know, you was talking about how like you was a big fan of Birdman with your music.
Yeah.
I don't want to say who you. I don't want to ask you who you sound like because I know you have your own sound.
Yeah.
But when you're listening to music, who do you? Who is your most influential artist?
For me, I mean, like, I would say Nas because I'm just, like, the biggest Nas fan ever. I think he's, like, one of the greatest writers of just our time. But
he doesn't get a lot
of
credit, though.
Yeah, I don't say. I mean, he don't get radio spins like that now. But, I mean, I think everybody knows, yo, Nas is that motherfucker. But I wouldn't say that, like, sonically I sound like him or stylistically I try to imitate him. I just think that just quality-wise, you know, he's such a good artist. When I heard Nas for the first time, that's like really what showed me, like, oh shit, yo, this could get deep, you know.
Uh-huh.
Before that, I was listening to what my sister bumped, and that was like Eazy-E, 3-6 Mafia, like she was a gangster. So I was just bumping what she bumped. But the first time I heard Nas, I was like, yo, this could get real deep, you know. That was like what made me fall in love with rapping.
I gotta think though that there's gotta be something conscious in your mind for anybody who's rapping, and you know, Mr. Walt's been around forever. I don't mean to date him or nothing with the Beatminerz, but you know, but that. A testament to what he's been able to do.
Yeah.
I would think that in the back of your mind, you're always conscious about somebody who influenced you not wanting to sound like that person, but still walking that fine line of, hey, this is somebody I look up to and somebody who influenced me when I first started writing.
And it's like, it's cool to imitate. You got to grow into your own too, you know? It's like, it's cool to learn from people stylistically and be like, oh, I could do this type of thing. But you gotta practice that and take it and make it your own, you know, and just figure out how you make it unique, you know?
You know what? I think that's kind of interesting that you said Nas is a great rapper. Can't take anything away from
you. Talking
East
to
Coast.
A lot of people from New York,
no,
just
no.
So you know.
Yeah. But
just
I
so
got,
you know.
No, I know that. But
Mr. Walt, cut your mic off.
I hate when I hear but after.
No,
right.
No, I was saying because I think that's kind of, I think that's good that Nas influenced you, but I got to think that you grew up in the era of the 8-Ball MJG.
Yeah,
in Orlando,
and I'm from Florida,
and
so
and
I just
Outkast,
like all we bump is
you know,
just Southern rap.
Yeah,
so Nas isn't popular where I'm from.
Yeah.
People aren't bumping. So I would say that my thing is like a fusion between because, you know, the biggest thing I take from the South is production, you know, like that's really what the South is to me is like, yo, just heavy hitting production. It's not some old New York style beats. It's some like, you know, really could ride to shit. So like, that's, I always love that, you know, but I just think content. content-wise, like Nas just blew my mind.
Oh, no,
with, like,
no disrespect to New York at all. Yeah. But I was just saying, you know, like like down south, like I'm assuming when you were growing up,
it's a vibe down
was,
south too.
The music
yeah.
was it was starting to it was starting to grow because that's when Outkast was starting to be big.
Yeah.
You know, like I said, 3-6 Mafia, 8-Ball MJG, Tila, you know, guys like that.
Look at you. Look at you.
Listen, I was down here. I was down here when the south started blowing up.
I was born in 92, so I was in.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You was a young guy. I'm talking about 95, 96. What was that, about 7, 8? That was about 8.
Yeah.
So I guess you weren't listening to that.
Well, my sister was bumping all that. If it wasn't for her, I wouldn't know anything.
So she's older than you.
Yeah, she's 7 years old.
So she's the main influence when you look at
the first song that I heard, the first rap song I can remember ever hearing was When I Say Weak
As You Say Bitch. Weak ass bitch.
Yo, I was like, I was in kindergarten or first grade.
3-6, baby.
I was scared. I was scared of rap. I was like, oh man, this is bad. Mom's going to be mad.
Well, yeah, I just dated myself. I'm old as hell because that's what I, you know,
man,
I was,
we already
I was
knew that
bumping,
one.
Bam, coming to Freaknik, bumping right. that thing.
So now Birdman, Cash Money, y'all can't get any season tickets for the magic out of this, Doug? I mean, come on, what's up,
honestly,
man?
Honestly, we could get season tickets without that. They
without home
court. But you don't care, though.
Yeah, I don't.
Yeah, it's bad.
Have you tried?
We don't have a great team right now, I don't think.
No.
At least from what Doug tells me, so I just like, I'm not interested. Yeah. When Doug tells me is where it's going, I'll be going.
If they're playing this year, the Cavs, the big teams, people are going to go
right,
out.
Right, right.
They're playing the Timberwolves. I'm sorry, but you could probably get a ticket off StubHub for $2.
Brother, listen, $2. I covered the Sixers during some dark years.
Oh,
he,
man,
he will tell
bad.
You.
It's
the only
bad.
Time people showed up was when LeBron, this was back when he went, you know, still
they
with the Cavs.
They tickets away. They
exactly.
were giving tickets away. Yeah.
Except when the Stars came in. And that was the best part
about it. Calling
his
phone trying to give him tickets.
Yeah, is that no, right?
They somehow got my number in their database, and it's to the point where as soon as I hear the guy's voice, I don't recognize the number. I'm like, oh, man, what do I got to tell him this time?
I don't want to go, you guys.
For the record, Hugh Douglas, Mr. Walt of the Beatminerz, Eytan Shander. We are joined by Caskey, Cash Money, his manager, Doug. Yeah. So have you tried? Is this like a continuing effort that just goes to waste trying to introduce him and get him to appreciate more of the sports world? Because now y'all have just made it in the hip-hop world, so.
Nah, I'll see somebody, and I'll be like, yo, that's such and such. Hey, yo, that's such and such. So when he sees him,
he saved me like a million times with like some really big athletes, and he's like,
yo,
yo,
give us one. Does one come to mind?
He in studio creating, man. He got time.
Well, I know. That's why I'm talking about his man. That's his people's job.
Chandler Parsons is from Orlando. He plays for the Mavericks now, but
right.
the Rockets the last few years, and he's from Orlando. So he's looking at Caskey as that rapper Austin Rivers. Doc Rivers' son, he's from Orlando.
Yeah, I
so they
Rivers.
Were like following him on Twitter and stuff, and were like, "Yo, I'm like letting them know, like, yo, these are that's a pretty big deal." Courtney Lee, a couple people live in Orlando, like
all following.
I'm starting to get more interested now. I think what I need to do is get a fantasy football team because that'll make me actually have to focus on some players
fantasy, don't
and
do
learn.
That, dog.
But no,
don't
but
do
I
that.
Think
fantasy
it'll make
football
me learn.
Sucks.
Nah, don't listen to him. Don't
but
listen to him.
But you feel me though? I think it'll make me focus on some players, learn about them, learn the other players
and
in the league
care.
And shit.
Really
yeah,
really
like
care.
Right now, I just
yeah, you know,
I tell you that's a genius idea. I
play
fantasy basketball just to keep up with that.
Yeah,
because you keep up news, guys get hurt, whatever.
Yeah.
And football's easier because it's once
money.
A week.
Yeah. Free leagues, you don't keep up.
Nah, we don't do free leagues.
Your money on the table.
We don't do free leagues.
I don't play because, like I was saying before you got in here, fantasy football players are annoying. You don't seem like an annoying cat, but they talk about they pick
their
the game
that you
apart.
Don't care about.
Yeah, but they pick the game apart too much. It's ridiculous, man. It's ridiculous.
All right, hold on.
Yeah, see,
listen. Only some of them. I don't do that.
No. This one, I apologize.
I'm
that's in the bag.
No, I don't want to. I don't have time to do that. Listen, I get excited Thursday, Sunday, and Monday. Tuesday, Wednesday, Friday, Saturday, I'm chilling. You know what I'm saying? Prepping my team, whatever, but I'm not going to sit there and decipher everything. Yo,
man,
you did this.
They do it. And they're like, hey, did you see that play on the goal line in the fourth quarter?
I don't do that.
Are you sure it's just not people upset with you? Like, yo, how did y'all not make that play?
No,
how did you lose that game?
You know what it is? It's people that see a big black guy, and they say, oh, he might have played, and they want to strike up a random football conversation. Hey, did you see that play in the fourth quarter or 2 minutes and 30 seconds left on the clock? Nah, dog, I know who won.
Right.
I know who lost.
Right.
Yeah, that's about it.
Don't listen to him. You're much better off with fantasy football. It'll help. All right, well, I don't want to put you on the spot or anything, but You kick a verse or something for us?
Yeah, I was wondering if he had the Shook Ones instrumental.
Mr. Walt,
I freestyle, but honestly, I ain't smoked any weed today.
Neither did I.
Does it help?
I just woke up. Yeah, hell yeah. Any type of drugs help.
See, we were talking about that.
I love rapping on
drugs. As Mr. Walt is answering your request here, we were talking about that, that guys that I cover, guys that Hugh played with, would smoke tree before going and playing an NFL game.
I couldn't do it.
Yo, actually, when I was in high school, I played lacrosse for like a year. Like, I wasn't good, but I was just trying to be in shape. But the varsity team that we had, they were killing it, and they used to get together before all their games and just smoke out and get high as fuck, and they was killing it. Yeah.
Last thing I want to do when I'm high is get hit.
Yeah. I feel like when I get high, sometimes I feel like I'm playing a sport.
I've never been high ever in life.
Well, you missing
out,
brother.
Nah, you've been high for sure. You just ain't been high of weed.
It's the same feeling you get when those endorphins release.
I've never been high on the marijuana cigarettes.
Yeah.
It's all about the same feeling you get from lifting.
Ever.
Yeah, right? Nah, it really is. It really is.
Right?
Just putting you in the moment. And
it's endorphins. Yeah, it's that's all.
I hear you.
Right. So as
I've been drunk.
Setting it up.
All good,
like,
brother.
Kind of like the same thing. You just don't lose.
But that's another one too,
control.
Where Hugh was talking about LT, Lawrence Taylor, and how he was drunk all the time before going out there and playing.
Who's that?
Lawrence Taylor.
Are you? No, he tripped. He
I really don't. Y'all think I'm kidding?
Seriously?
Nah, I don't know.
See, we take but it's because you're a young buck. That's all. You're 20. You know, a lot of the young guys don't know who he is.
Bro, I know. I know Dennis Rodman.
That's all.
I know.
And he played basketball.
Dr. J. Yeah.
And you know what? I'm not mad at you. You're in the studio creating.
I'm trying
That's
to learn.
Right,
yeah. I'm trying
That's
to
right.
learn. I'm so. When I was younger, I wasn't interested because my dad was a really good sports player when he was in high school. He played football, basketball, baseball. He was a big motherfucker, and he tried to push me to play sports all the time. And
like,
he
was like, fuck
he
that,
was heated
dad.
When I wasn't good at it, and I was just like, yo, fuck this. I picked up a guitar. I was like, yo, I'm making music.
So your dad was that guy who was out there yelling at you all the
time?
Well,
my sister at one point was like the number 6 tennis player in the state.
Wow.
Yo, like she was a
Oh,
she
so
was
your sister
dope.
Got some nice
yo,
ass
she's
legs.
Dope. Yo, I mean, yo.
I mean, no disrespect. No disrespect. No disrespect. But I'm just saying.
Dope. She was like tennis 15 at the time, so I hope you ain't checking out her legs. But he was like a real hard ass with her playing and shit. So it was
wow.
Like,
so
I just kind of steered away from
you're
it.
Like, screwed out, I'm making music.
Yeah, I was like,
seems fuck. Like it worked out all right for you.
Yeah, it worked out great, yo.
And look at that, right on cue, Mr. Walt. It's your world, brother.
Check it out now. Check it out now. This the instrumental?
Yeah, well. Yeah, to loop it up.
I say even when I ain't got the juice on me, my troops get popping in pills and a loose on me appear. Fuck that sucker shit you call your career. 2014, I'm killing all that shit. You disappear like a UFO after the sighting. Don't come around my city rocking chains on. It's rather inviting to my associates that's gang affiliated. I made a couple cars and you ain't affiliated with none of them. Who trying to camouflage? I'm hunting them, snipe them up, duct tape mouth, then hunting them. Egypt style, I'm King Tutting them. Forgotten like Manchester. Forgotten like the pure knowledge of my ancestors. Pussy. Forgotten like my social security number. Y'all saying I'ma fall off with this rap shit. Well, that's like saying 666, the purity number. I mean, it holds no logic. I put the 4-5 at the hands of the man with the gold wallet and tell him don't hide it. What you think? I'm on my nice guy shit. Just cause I signed on a dotted sucker. Not I though. I'm rolling around town. Ducking 5-0. Fucking my bitch. She hitting high notes. You see me better tucking your shit. Cause in the land of the instrumental, no such thing as halfway ripped. I'm taking shots at the competition. Like they first name Hennessy. I'm drinking out the remedy still. I play a game of soccer all up on your energy field. Rocking a smirk that got Kennedy killed. I let your legacy build up. So I can build and destroy. Rap dead while I'm filling the void. They derive a lot of happiness from winning while I'm killing their joy. Christmas morning and I'm stealing their toy. Look, if y'all feeling the boy, let your head knock. Only officer I ever speak to in my city. Well, that's a dead cop. They swear they cash money, live in a mansion. They saw them bedrock. Well, that's some fairy tale shit. Send you lead shots to insulin shit for your med shots. You sugar sweet. Headlocks, I'm Booker T. My dogs talk cocaine, I'm cocaine white. Swear that I'm Pusha T. Rottweilers with crooked teeth. Backing out the back alley with decoys. Don't look at me. Tell Bieber about that time you throw a hook at me. I give you all of the publishing. Yo, just let me get an Instagram flick and tell my dogs I fuck with them. Fuck 100 different bitches off the strength. Yeah.
Ah.
Yeah. I had these bitches in third state.
When he get high, because that was pretty damn good. Right? Off the rip. Off the rip.
Killed it.
Yeah. I like rapping, man. I rap with no beat if y'all want.
So let me ask you, why Shook Ones? Because I'm, you know, New York mob is my life.
I had written to one day. I just sometimes when we don't got beats and shit from producers that we like, we just go into the vault and start digging up classics and like seeing what we could do on them.
Love it, man. Love it. Nas, yeah. Shook Ones.
Yeah. That's what I got to get next. I got to get on that Nas is like, that's a classic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It doesn't sound like that anymore, man. Production? What's up with that? Why did everything leave New York?
I ran into Ninth Wonder the other day and he was telling me he still got that soulful shit. So I'm like interested to see what he got and like,
did he say Suge?
No, he'll give it to you.
Yeah.
Suge Knight. Is that what he said?
Who are you talking about? Just now?
Yeah.
No.
Oh, okay, my bag. I'm sure.
Yeah.
I heard Suge.
Ninth Wonder, the producer. Nah, he said he still got that soulful shit.
Oh, nice. I said Suge. I thought, didn't Suge get beat up a couple weeks ago?
Yeah,
somebody, right?
Yeah, somebody knocked him out.
Did they knock him out or was it caps flying?
I don't know why. Like, you know what? I got ADD, man. I don't know where that came from.
Hey, he's running, yo. You can talk about Suge getting beat up, but we ain't saying nothing.
Yeah. That's Hugh Douglas that said that for the record.
No, I'm telling you, dude. I got ADD. I like my chances against Suge.
Yeah, me too. I seen Hugh go at it. I like my chances with you against most men.
I ain't scared of Suge.
Unless they packing.
If he got a gun, all bets are off.
Right? All right, brother, how can we find out more about you? Website,
I just
Twitter.
Followed him on Twitter.
Exactly.
Okay, yeah, follow me on Twitter, Instagram, Caskey47, CaskeY47. BaconWithCaskey.com is my website. We launching a new website in like a week or two. We're going to start dropping new music. We got a new project coming in November. It's about to be Caskey season all over again.
Can't thank you enough, brother.
Thank y'all very much.
All the best.
Appreciate the hospitality.
You got it. Caskey, Cash Money Manager, yes, Doug. Sir. Appreciate you, fellas. Thank you.
Appreciate
for Hugh Douglas.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Walt of the Beatminerz, Eytan Shander for the record.